Good morning to all. I welcome you all for the online classes of St. Lawrence School. I, Ms. Nirupama Roochand, is going to teach biology of class 10th, and the chapter is circulatory system. Now, you know that children, that whenever we have to move from one place to another, what we do? We hire a transport system. Now the transport system helps us to move from one area to another and wherever we want to go. Similarly, in our body, we have a system which comprises of blood. You can see here, heart, blood, lymph and vessels. As it is written here also. So these four things which are there in our body helps to circulate or transport various things in our body. For example, food or the digested nutrients, hormones, enzymes, and the gases. Now, what are the functions of these categories? We will be studying one by one. According to the study of circulatory system, blood and lymph, they are the fluid part of the circulatory system. They are the liquid part and they hold the connective tissue mechanism. So let us see the functions of the blood. The remaining ones we will do in the next study. The first function is it transports the digested nutrients. As you can see here, oxygen, exchange of gases like carbon dioxide is given out. So all this occurs through a channel that is called as blood. And it is transported by way of vessels. So vessels are tube-like structures or tunnel-like which helps to transport these substances. It also distributes heat, helps in clotting of blood, which we will be studying one by one in the coming topics. It produces antibodies and antitoxins. Now we have the blood vessel. Now as I was talking to you, that blood is the fluid part which helps to carry all the constituents of the body so that each and every cell of our body receives them. And therefore, for that transportation, okay, we need a vehicle. Similarly, we need a vehicle here that is a blood vessel. Now this blood vessel, as you can see, is a tunnel-like structure and it is hollow from inside. And inside it, we have a structure like this. Now the blood consists of the plasma, which is the liquid part, and within the plasma are present corpuscles or the blood cells. Now you must have eaten a custard, a fruit custard. Now what is there in that? The custard, the pudding part which is there, it is the liquid part or a little thick viscosity is there. And the cells which are there, you can compare it as the fruits which are added in the custard. So here we find that plasma is the liquid part or the fluid part of the blood. And these three corpuscles or the cells are the main cells of the blood. What are they? We have red blood cells, as you can see there. We have white blood cells and the platelets. Now, the blood is made up of, as I've already told you, plasma and corpuscles. Plasma is the liquid part of the blood and the corpuscles are the other structures. Now here we have, this is the diagram of the first corpuscle that we will be studying, that is RBC. Now RBC, the full form is red blood corpuscles. Also they are biologically known as erythrocytes. Now what is these? If you see the diagram, they are biconcave structure, means concave from both the sides, and also we call them as disc-shaped structure. They are denucleated, means without nucleus. Now nucleus is present only when they were formed. At the time of their immaturation, they are formed. But as the RBCs mature, these nucleus disappear. Now the reason is because they have to accommodate more and more hemoglobin pigment so that more and more oxygen can be bound and it can be transported to various parts of the body. So that is all given here. As you can see, so hemoglobin is a red color pigment and it is made up of two components. If you break up, you will find that is hematin and globin. Now hematin of the hemoglobin is a main pigment, okay, and it contains iron. That means iron is very, you must have heard that we should take iron in our food, because the reason is iron makes up the hemoglobin protein. Okay, so hemoglobin is made from iron. Then we have another part, that is globin, a protein part of the hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is made up of two components, hematin and globin. The lifespan of RBCs is 120 days, as you can see here, and they are formed in the red bone marrow. Now this is found in the bones, the hollow bones of our body, and they are destroyed. If the RBC after 120 days, it gets destroyed. So they are destroyed in the liver, spleen, and also in the bone marrow. Then we have the next category, that is WBCs. Now WBCs are the white blood corpuscles, also known as leukocytes, and they are amoeboid in shape. Amoeboid means they can assume any shape, and they have nucleus which are of variant type that we will be studying. Let us see the main functions of WBCs in the body. Like RBCs, their function is to bind oxygen and transport to various parts of the body. Similarly, WBC function are of three kinds: phagocytosis, they act as scavengers, and they help in the formation or the production of the protection of our body from the germs. So they are called as the soldiers of the body. Now the first, phagocytosis. Let us see if we have a WBC and we find any germs found in the surrounding, what will happen? They will engulf. Engulf means they will extend their arms, pteropodia arms, and they will engulf or swallow those germs and kill them. And in the course of time, they also get destroyed. So that is why it is called as phagocytosis. Means to completely swallow or engulf the foreign particles. Now foreign particles are the germs, and kills them. Second category, scavengers. Scavengers, like you know, that they are the organisms which feed on dead organisms. So they also, suppose if any worn out tissue or any destroyed part of the tissue is there or cell is there in the body, that has to be cleaned from the body. So that is done by the help of these WBCs. The third is they act as the soldiers of the body, protecting the body from various germs. Suppose there is any cut or injury, there they function mainly. And then they are also produced in the bone marrow, and their lifespan is 1 week. Now we come to the classification of WBC. The classification makes two sections. We have agranulocyte and granulocyte. Now you can see in the diagram, agranulocytes are of two types. We have monocyte and lymphocyte. And similarly, we have granulocytes, which are of three types, starting with eosinophil, which is also known as acidophil. We have basophil and we have the neutrophil. The first agranulocyte type we have is the monocyte. As you can see in the diagram, they have a kidney shape. If you see the nucleus inside it, it is kidney shape, and that is also amoeboid in shape, as you have seen, and their main function is to take part in phagocytosis. Lymphocytes, they are round in shape. Now, if you see the nucleus inside, it covers the entire space of the cell. So we find they have a large nucleus and they produce antibodies. Now, what are antibodies? When any germs enter into our body fights with them. Our body proteins fights with them. And in this course of time, we find that our body forms antibody in the first attempt when they see the microorganisms or the germs. So that next time when the germs attack, now the ready-made antibodies, they do not allow them to enter into a body. So they just become like a strong soldier which are being formed in the beginning. So these are the antibodies. Then we come to the granulocyte type. The three are acidophil, also known as eosinophil. They are basically classified or distinguished by the structure of their nucleus. In the eosinophil, you will find they have bilobed nucleus. Now, bilobed means the nucleus is not divided actually. It is not divided, but it becomes in such a way that it appears as two. So, they are bilobed nucleus. Their cytoplasm is alkaline in nature. That is the reason they are called as acidophil. And they secrete antitoxins which kills the germs and cause allergy. The next is basophil. They are acidic in nature. Now, they are always opposite to their name. And their main structure is they have three lobed nuclei. Okay, and they dilate the blood vessels. Dilate means they expand the blood vessels so that the blood can flow very fast and can secrete various histamines which can cause anti-allergic conditions. The last is the neutrophils. If you see, you will find they are multi-lobed structures. Okay, they have many lobes and they take part in phagocytosis. Now, in all these WBCs, if we talk about, they all are formed in the red bone marrow, except we have the lymphocyte. The lymphocytes are produced in the liver and spleen. So these are the only, you can say, WBCs which are produced in liver and spleen. The rest all are produced in the red bone marrow. The third category of corpuscles or cells found in the blood after RBCs, WBCs is the blood platelets. They are also known as thrombocytes and their main function, as you can see, they help in clotting of the blood. They are the smallest sized corpuscles because they are very small in size and normally they are found at the periphery of the blood vessel. They are formed again in the red bone marrow of the long bones and their lifespan is 3 to 5 days. Now let us see the various ways by which they function. If we need to have a blood clotting, now why we need a blood clot? Suppose we have a cut or injury on any part of the body. So there what happens, the blood comes out and the appearance of the blood is red color. Why? Because hemoglobin is coming out from the vessel. So all the hemoglobin, that is RBCs, WBCs, all starts coming out from the injured part of the blood. Suppose this is the blood vessel and there is a cut here. So all RBCs, WBCs and everything starts coming out. And thereby our blood appears to be red in color. Now what happens at the site of injury, we find that the blood platelets, they destroy and they release an enzyme which is called as thromboplastin. Also it is known as thrombokinase. Now initially it was prothrombin, the reason of prothromboplastin, the reason is because they were in their inactive form. But as the platelets destroy, these enzymes become active and they are called as thromboplastin. Now in the presence of calcium ion, this thromboplastin converts prothrombin, which is a type of protein found in the blood, to thrombin. And then we find this thrombin converts fibrinogen. The fibrinogen, which is a type of soluble protein. It is soluble because everything is dissolved in it. But what happens when these are dissolved in it, so they are easy to, they are finding free to move. But what happens, this fibrinogen is converted to fibrin. Now fibrin is an insoluble form. Actually it is seen as a network. So it forms a network and thereby covers the whole of the surface and prevents all the RBCs, WBCs. WBCs still can squeeze out, but RBCs mainly are prevented to come out from the blood vessel. And thereby, it prevents the blood from losing all the RBCs. And this is called as, after some time we see on the cut or injury site, a clot appears. And that clot is actually because of the formation of this fibrin or network layer. So this procedure is done by platelets or the blood platelets, which we call. Now this blood platelets are formed, as I have told you, in the red bone marrow. Now there are specialized cells in the red bone marrow which are called as megakaryocyte. Now the next topic, which is little different from what we have done on the basis of the classification of the blood and its type. We have in the blood, you must have heard that if we have to donate the blood to any person, so what happens is we need to have a same matching, or maybe the blood group should have this or that. For example, if I have blood group A, then I can donate the blood to A, or I can receive the blood from A. Similarly, a person who has O blood group can only take the blood from O and also can give to all. So here we find that we have four major blood groups. Now these blood groups are based on the antigens that are present in our body. For example, if we have an antigen A, that means I have a blood group A. If in my body the antigen present is B, that is called as the blood group B. And similarly, if we have both the antigens A, B, so the blood group will be considered as AB. And if a person has no antigen, that means neither A nor B, that means it is zero. So we don't call it zero, but we give an alphabet to it, that is O. So we have four types of blood groups, A, B, AB and O. Now AB is a universal recipient. Every person who is having a AB blood group can receive from A also. It can receive the blood from B, AB or O. So therefore we call it as a universal recipient. The second category is group O. Group O is a universal donor because it can donate to blood group A, to B and O also and AB also. Now the blood group A which is there, like I already told you, it contains antigen A and antibody B. Now antibody is the body or the protein which is working against it, but it is present in order to fight with the blood group B. And similarly we find blood group B contains antigen B but antibody A. Now what happens is when this blood group is being given to any person who is having blood group B. So if the blood group A is given to blood group B person, what will happen? The antibody present in it is A. So it will not allow, what will happen as the blood enters here, this will cause clumping of the blood or it will fight. The antibody present here will fight with the blood group A. As a result, what will happen? That they will not be able to take the blood or the blood will clot inside. Therefore, it is necessary that before we transfuse the blood has to be matched or it should be compatible. Biologically, we call it as a compatible. And these are the conditions. Similarly, we go for blood group B also and same way for blood group AB also. So blood group O contains neither antigen A or B, but it contains antibody A and B both. Now, because we find that blood group O contains neither of these antibodies, contains both the antibodies A and B, so the result is that it cannot take, because if any blood is given to it, antibody is already present to fight with the blood group. So it can give to others, but it cannot take. Therefore, it becomes a universal donor. Now, according to the blood study we find, or the blood group study, we have another type of blood group that is being seen in the blood of the people, and that is called as Rh positive. Now, or Rh factor we call it. If it is present in the blood, it is called as Rh positive, and if it is absent in the blood, then it is called as Rh negative. Now, this was first studied in a rhesus monkey. Now, there are many more things that we have to study from the blood group and the Rh factor types. And we will go in the next session. And I hope you have enjoyed the first part of the chapter. And we will continue in the coming chapters. Thank you and have a nice day.